Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgave the iniquity of my sin.
O Almighty God, merciful Father,
I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them. And I pray you, Lord, for your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, who be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinner like me.
Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you, and in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Be gracious to me and answer me, O you.
We are unworthy of all these mercies, and have rather deserved punishment. But forgive us our sins, as you forgave Peter, and prosper and bless us in our different callings, that by your strength we may be sustained and defended, now and forever. And so praise and glorify you eternally. You live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one true God, now and forever. Please be seated. Testament reading for the fifth Sunday after Trinity is from 1 Kings chapter 19. The Lord said, "Go out and stand on the mount before the Lord." And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind tore the mountains and broke in pieces the rocks before the Lord. The Lord was not in the wind, and after the wind, an earthquake. The Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. The Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, the sound of a low whisper. And when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his cloak and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. And behold, there came a voice to him and said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He said, "I have been very jealous for the Lord, God of hosts, for the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. And I, even I only, am left, and they seek my life to take it away." And the Lord said to him, "Go, turn on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. You shall anoint Hazael to be king over Syria, and Jehu, the son of Nimshi, you shall anoint to be the king over Israel. And Elisha, the son of Shaphat, of Abel-Meholah, you shall anoint and be prophet in your place. And the one who escapes from the sword of Hazael shall Jehu put to death. And the one who escapes from the sword of Jehu shall Elisha put to death. Did I believe 7,000 in Israel, all the knees that have not bowed to Baal, and every mouth that has not kissed him?" So he departed from there and found Elisha, the son of Shaphat, who was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen in front of him, and he was with 12. Elijah passed by him and cast his cloak upon him. And he left the oxen and ran after Elijah and said, "Let me kiss my father and my mother, and then I will follow you." And he said to him, "Go back again, for what have I done to you?" And he returned from following him and took the yoke of oxen and sacrificed them and boiled their flesh with the yokes of the oxen and gave it to the people. Then he arose and went after Elijah and assisted him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
chapter 3. Finally, all of you, have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, tender heart, and a humble mind. Do not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, bless, for to this you are called, that you may obtain a blessing. For whoever desires to love life and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil, and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Now who is there to harm you if you are zealous for what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled. But in your hearts regard Christ, the Lord, as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Be righteous.
Yeah.
in the gospel reading, we have the event, the occasion, which is the calling of St. Peter, or the calling of Simon. It isn't just limited, by the way, to Peter. Right? There's James and John, who are his business partners. They're all in on the fishing business. They all hear the preaching and teaching. They all observe the miracle. And in the end, all of them follow. But typically, this day is still called the calling of St. Peter or Simon. When it comes to this calling, something that we should know before we get into the details is this is not the first time that Simon or Peter has had some experience, some interaction with Jesus. He knows about Jesus' baptism. He knows about the preaching and teaching that's taking place in Capernaum. Just before this, in Luke chapter 4, there's a kind of a healing event which takes place, which is recorded for us, where the town is turning out and all of the sick are being brought to Jesus. He's healing them. But the first person that seems to be healed is no less than Peter's mother-in-law, Simon's mother-in-law. And so Jesus and Peter, Jesus and Simon, they do have some experience. They do have some interactions before this day. But what does Peter believe about Jesus? Well, he certainly doesn't think he's the Lord. He's a rabbi. What does Peter think about Jesus? Well, he doesn't have faith in him as the Messiah, faith in him as the Christ. He's just the local rabbi, nice guy, glad to see that he's doing what he's doing. Well, coming then to the lake on that day, Gennesaret, Tiberias, Galilee, it's all the same place. The people are pressing in because they've heard the word of God. Maybe they've seen some of these miracles, right? Jesus, in their minds, great, great person to be around. He knows the word of God. He preaches with authority. Great person to be around. If you have sickness, real sickness, you can take them to him, and he will heal them. So the people are following. The people are pressing. The people are after Jesus. And here they are on the shore of Gennesaret, the shore of Galilee. And, well, Jesus is sort of pressed up against the lake. It's almost like the people of Israel pressed up against the Red Sea with the Egyptians pursuing. Here he is, all those folks that are pressing in. And so what he does is he basically commandeers. He basically takes one of these boats, and it is the boat of Simon. Now, what I wanted to say was it just happened to be the boat of Simon, just happened to be the boat of Peter. But, of course, that's totally false. None of this is by way of chance. None of this is just by way of, well, it just worked out that way. Jesus is at this place, at this time, for the purpose of recruiting Simon, recruiting James, recruiting John at the beginning of the ministry, to be his disciples, yes, but ultimately to be witnesses going forward who would preach and teach the good news of Jesus Christ after the Christ had fulfilled all things given to him, after his death, after his resurrection, and after his ascension. And so Jesus takes the boat, commandeers the boat, asks Simon to put out a little way. Now, by the way, Simon here has been waiting. He has come in from evening work. He is washing and mending nets, and so are James and John. So he's not particularly busy. And the reason for that is he didn't catch anything during the night, neither did James and John. So he's there essentially at his ease cleaning these nets, and then he gets that request, may I use your boat? I'm using your boat. And can you put it out a little way from the water so I can speak to the people? Well, this is a great kind of a buildup for a sermon, like Sermon on the Mount. Right? You've got the healings that are taking place, you've got people that are following him, you've got these other folks who are here on the side and observing these things, and now you're going to get a real crackerjack, great sermon from Jesus, and what is recorded? Nothing. Not a single word. Not even in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Nothing at all. And the point there is, because there is a point, is that in the end, what this whole circumstance is about, the reason why it has been recorded, is we already have some sense of the preaching and teaching of Jesus. Right? It's about repentance. It's about confessing sins. It's about the kingdom of God that has come among us in Jesus Christ. It's about God who is fulfilling his promises in Christ. It's about grace and mercy and peace and things that are ours now because of Christ, because of his life, death, and his resurrection. So we already have a sense that that's the kind of preaching that's taking place, so we don't get a single word of it. But what we do know is that Simon is there, Peter is there, and he's listening. Now, I think James and John are listening as well, because in the end they believe, and they're not so far off. But Simon, Peter here, he really doesn't have any opportunity, any ability to not listen to Jesus, because here they are in a boat, and Jesus is there, and he happens to be sitting right next to him. So he definitely is listening, he's definitely hearing the words. And then when the sermon concludes, well, you think, okay, that's the end of it. They're going to go back into the shore, Jesus is going to get off, he's going to go away, and the crowds are going to follow him. But that's not what takes place. Rather than going in, what Jesus says, Peter, Simon, is, let's take your boat out into the deep water here. Now this is already after sun up, right? This is already maybe even in the direction of noon or something like this. Let's go out into the deep water. Let's throw your nets, which you've just washed, by the way, and mended and whatever else you do with them. Let's take those nets and dip them into the water, and what we'll do is we'll pull out a catch. Well, you know, Peter's a fisherman by trade. He does this for a living. He's not an amateur. He's nothing like that. He does this for a living. He's a commercial fisherman. People in Jerusalem know of these folks because they buy their fish. And here you have this rabbi. Where's he from? Nazareth? That's not even on Galilee. That's way up there in the hills. You have this rabbi. Sure, he's good at the scriptures. He's good at preaching and teaching. But his suggestion is, now that he's been there speaking loudly to the people, this is going to attract fish. Now that Peter and James and John have had this whole night trying to catch fish, using all of their expertise, using all of their wisdom in this business, and have caught nothing. Now it's essentially getting to be noon in the middle of the day, and the sun's up, and all those kinds of good things. Every single thing goes against the idea this is the right opportunity, the proper time for catching fish. And here you have the rabbi, hey, let's go out and catch some fish. Right? It's just what amateurs always say. Well, will he do it or will he not do it? I mean, just employing reason, just doing what's sensible, he'll explain. We're not doing this. It's not going to work. We're not going to catch anything. It's not going to be a good idea. If you want to catch fish, come out with us tonight. If you want to catch fish, meet us here maybe early in the morning. But what Peter does say is, at your word, I will do it. And I really love that phrase. I really love those words that are put together. Because he only knows Jesus as the rabbi. But he does know that Jesus is the one who was able to heal all of these folks. Something to that. Maybe a prophet. And here at your word, even though he doesn't yet recognize him as Messiah, does not yet recognize him as God in the flesh, at your word, we'll do what you're requesting. We're doing what you desire. But let's be honest, with no real hope of catching any fish. Well, out they go then into the water, the deeper water. Out they go into that place which is, should not be a place where there are fish available. Should not be a place where we're going to have this kind of catch. And at Jesus' word, at God in the flesh's word, they drop those nets into the water. And there is a catch. It's a miraculous catch. It makes no sense kind of a catch. And it's not just a couple of fish. Hey, amateurs always get lucky the first time they try, right? I've never played darts before, bullseye, right? I've never played baseball before, cracked out of the park. And then after that, they can never do it again. No, this is not one fish, two fish, lucky kind of thing. This is the greatest catch of Peter's life. This is the catch where the nets are completely and totally filled to such a degree that when they begin to pull them in and they see the size, the enormity of the catch, they already know, hey, we've got to call in our friends with their boat because there's no way we're going to put all of these fish into our boat. And now the two boats are out there, James and John are out there, maybe Andrew's out there as well, his name's not really expressed. They're filling these boats, and these boats then begin to sink. Well, it's right there at that moment something miraculous happens. Peter recognizes in this situation that the person who is in the boat with him is no less than the Lord, no less than God in human flesh. And this is not a thing that Hebrews, monotheists, typically come up with. They believe in one God. They believe in Yahweh. They believe he was the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the one who was leading Moses. That person does not have human flesh. That person does not pop in and out willy-nilly for fishing trips and those sorts of things, right? And so what Peter has here and what he's expressing in his words is he has faith that has been worked in his heart and worked in his mind, granted to him by no less than the Holy Spirit. It has to be that way. Because nobody sees these things, believes these things, comes to know these things without the word, without the revelation of the Holy Spirit. That's what takes place. But how does it take place? Through the sermon. The sermon of which we have no details, we know was preached. The sermon, where we have none of those words, was spoken in the presence of Peter in that boat. And like I said, we basically know the contours, the lines, the things that Jesus basically talks about. And it is about the kingdom of God. It is about the Messiah. It is about the forgiveness of sins. It is about God fulfilling his promises and those sorts of things. And he has that rattling around in his brain at the same time that he sees this miracle, which is absolutely a miracle and can be explained in no other possible way. It's not just a lucky break. And it's these actions put together with these words that the Holy Spirit uses and brings Peter to faith, brings him to believe that he is in the presence of God, and no less than that. This is the Lord is with me in the boat. Now, if you come to that conclusion, and you come to that position, and you're Peter, then what do you do? Because Peter's actions recorded here are significant. Peter's actions, they teach us quite a bit. Well, first of all, what we know is he is afraid. Later on, Jesus tells him, don't be afraid, because he's definitely afraid. And why is he afraid? Because he knows things like Isaiah chapter 6, where Isaiah finds himself in the presence of the righteous and holy God. Isaiah finds him in the kind of a place where sinners ought not be. And what does he say? Woe unto me, I'm a sinner, and I come from sinful people, and his expectation is he will immediately die. Now God doesn't kill him, he cleanses him, puts the gold to the lips, etc., etc. But Peter here has the right kind of response. This is the holy and righteous God in the boat with me. This is the one who is without sin, who is in the boat with me. This is the creator of all things, heaven and earth, who is in the boat with me. And so his first expression of faith, true faith, is, depart from me, O Lord. Get away from me. You're holy and I'm not. You're righteous and I'm not. Depart from me. Maybe there's a little bit of self-preservation here because he recognizes the reality. He recognizes the truth. This is God in human flesh standing in all places in the boat with him. But what does Jesus say to him? Do not be afraid. And you see, that's the thing we see so often, especially at the beginning of the New Testament, the beginning of the Gospels here. Mary, she runs into that angelic presence, the angel, right? It's heaven sort of transferred. It's certainly less than God, but no less than a heavenly presence. And she is afraid. Fear not. To Joseph, the same thing. Fear not. Because in terms of our sin, when we're in the presence of the righteous or in the presence of the holy, presence of that which comes from heaven, we know we don't belong there. But what Jesus says to him is fear not, do not be afraid. Because Jesus' purpose is not to bring him out on a boat, catch these fish, and then destroy him as sinner. That's not the purpose for which Jesus has come. Jesus rather has come to give comfort to sinners. Jesus has come to bring aid to sinners. Jesus has come not to confirm us in our sins, but ultimately to deliver us from our sins, to redeem us from our debts, to take away our sins forevermore by way of his life, by way of his death, and by way of his resurrection from the grave. And so fear not, not in the sense of it's no big deal, it's the biggest of all deals. You're in the presence of God. But God is here on this day for you, Peter, not to destroy you, but to reconcile you, to restore you, to even make use of you in that ministry, which is the ministry of the extension of God's grace, the extension of God's mercy, to the extension of the forgiveness of sins, not just to Peter, but to others. And so Peter then, after that, goes to shore with Jesus. And again, who knows what the conversation is along the way. Great stuff to be known. But when he gets out of that boat, what it says is, he basically laid down everything. He gave up on everything, and he followed Jesus. And what this is about is, this is for us now, image and picture of what the Christian faith is all about. That we, like Peter, are sinners. From our birth, from the time of our conception, we, like Peter, are not righteous and holy in our thoughts and our words and in our deeds. We, like Peter, are in no position to be in the presence of God unless God does something to allow that to occur. God does something to overcome that sinful condition, which is, of course, what Christ does. And once we receive that forgiveness of sins, once we have that revelation which comes to us by way of the Holy Spirit, once we're baptized, once we've been converted by way of the Word, as we receive the body and blood of Christ, say, in the sacrament, that has to change everything for us in terms of how we look at the world. Peter leaves behind all of the stuff, leaves behind his job, leaves behind this and that, and he goes off and follows Jesus, and this is his vocation. But all of us are not called to be apostles. In fact, none of us are. There's just the 12 and maybe the plus one. But we are called as Christians to give up on all the worldly things around us, which contradict, which oppose, which work against the word and the will of God himself. That's the kind of life that we're called to, the way Peter's called to. You leave it behind and you follow Jesus. And the reason why this is the case, the reason why this is so important for us to think about, to recognize, to consider, and to pursue, is this. It's because everything else that we have in the world is essentially passing. Even the good things that are given to us by God, house and home, wife and children, field, cattle, and all my goods, food, drink, all those kinds of good things. They are good things, but they're things that are passing, things that are fading away. The thing that is eternal, the thing that remains forever, are those things that Christ came to accomplish. The forgiveness of our sins, that is an accomplished thing. You have that in no other place but in Christ himself. The real and true love of God. The world has all kinds of versions of love, and many of them are a perverted form of love, a disordered form of love. That's how it is. But in Christ and in Holy Church and with God, you have love as it was intended to be, as it is. Because you're with God and you are his creation. He loves us and we love him. In Christ, we have life. Not just the life that people pursue in this world. We have life beginning in this world. We have it even now. And life that endures with God forevermore. In the world, you have none of these things. In Christ, you have all of these things. And so, if not just for wisdom's sake, we look at what happens here with Peter. And our greatest prayer, our greatest desire, is that God would call us, that God would drag us in the direction of following him, even as Peter did. And remember Peter's sins, by the way. Peter is not without sin after this fact. But what Peter had learned, he himself did not create it. Peter learned, and what was revealed to him is that Christ, and in Christ alone, he is the one who is worth pursuing. He is the one who is worth following. Because of who he is our Savior. Because of who he is our Redeemer. Because who he is the Holy One of God sent to us to deliver us and to bring us to his Father and to bring us to the Spirit. And so for this Jesus Christ and for this great interaction with Peter in the boat, we offer all of our thanks. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We rise. The peace of God that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. this time, please invite forward those who have been elected to office, any office in the church. If you've been elected to serve on a board as a chairperson or anything like that, we invite you forward now. Today is the day for the installation, and we will install you in your offices, and then tomorrow, you officially take up your duties July 1st. So if you've been elected to any office this year or even last year, please come forward now, and we will conduct the rite of installation. Any new faces? Any dual guard? Very good. I'm sure that some young people are old enough to serve on the board. Meantime. Beloved in the Lord, Holy Scripture admonishes us that all things should be done decently and in order. In addition, the Apostle Peter writes, as each has received a gift, use it to serve one another. As good stewards of God's very grace, whoever speaks as one who speaks oracles of God, whoever serves as one who serves by the strength that God supplies, in order that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. To him belong glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Dear brothers and sisters, you have been chosen to fill specific offices and positions of responsibility at Emmanuel Lutheran Church. You are to work with the pastors that our life together in Christ may be orderly and pleasing in his sight. You are to see that the services of God's house are held at the proper times, that the word of God is purely preached and taught according to the Lutheran confessions, that the sacraments of Christ are administered according to his institution, that provision is made for the Christian instruction of young and old, that the erring are admonished, and that discipline is maintained. You are to see that the temporal affairs of the congregation are properly administered, and that proper support is provided for the workers of this congregation. You are to assist in caring for the poor and the sick, in cultivating harmony among the members, in promoting the general welfare of the congregation, and in furthering the kingdom of Christ here and throughout the world. While holiness of life and obedience to Christ are expected of all members of this congregation, it is especially important that you, as office bearers in this church, show yourselves by word and example to be faithful to Him in service and Christian devotion. In the presence of God and of this congregation, I therefore ask you, do you accept the offices entrusted to you? And do you promise faithfully to carry out your duties, trusting in the Lord and conforming yourself to his word in accordance with the faith of the evangelical church? If so, then answer, I do.
I do.
Beloved in the Lord, you have heard the promises of faithfulness spoken by these men and women, whom you have selected to serve as officers of Emmanuel Lutheran Church. Do you promise to support them in their work, to remember them in your prayers, and to work with them to the best of the abilities that God has given you, so that he may be glorified and his work be done in our midst? If so, then answer, we do. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, I install you as officers of Emmanuel Lutheran Church, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Almighty and most merciful God, enlighten and strengthen you in your offices, that you may be good and faithful stewards to the glory of his name and the good of his people. Amen. We rise for prayer. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we give thanks that you have raised up these servants for work among your people. We humbly implore you to grant them, by your Holy Spirit, those gifts needed for the faithful carrying out of their tasks, most especially wisdom, strength, and willing hearts. Let your blessing rest on this congregation. Strengthen the faith, quicken the love, and enkindle the zeal of its members, that your name may be glorified, and that here and in all places under heaven, the kingdom of your Son may be advanced. We remember with thanksgiving those who have faithfully served your people and have now completed their time of service. We pray that in the end of days, we, with all your faithful people, hear the voice of Christ saying, come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And receive this blessing. Go in the name of the Lord. be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. The Almighty and most merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless and preserve you.
Amen.
Thank you.
when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
you have refreshed us with a salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy, you can strengthen us, staying in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
My Lord be with you. Please give it to Stephen Hernandez and we'll get it in the next edition of the directory.